Find out what it's like to experience the world from above. Fly your own drone today. DroneCloneExperts.com specializes in high-quality, affordable drones. Now introducing their Limitless 2 model, equipped with a 4K camera for stunning Ultra HD clarity, GPS with precision auto return, and up to 25 minutes flight time on a single charge. Visit DroneCloneExperts.com now and enter promo code RADIO to receive 15% off your entire order. That's DroneCloneExperts.com.
Hey, this is Wix Patton, and you're listening to Verbal Shenanigans. Y'all tap in right now.
But our shenanigans are cheeky and fun.
Yeah, I mean, his shenanigans are cruel and tragic.
Which makes them not shenanigans at all, really.
Evil shenanigans.
I swear to God, I'll pistol whip the next guy that says shenanigans.
Welcome all the ugly people in the world to the show.
Are you offended? Are you going to cancel us?
Listen, there's plenty of ugly people here. I have the entire list in front of me. I'm going to read it off, and they're going to be so pissed off when they're like, you mean Scott Brandon didn't say welcome to me just because I'm butt ugly? Thank you, Scotty.
I'm sorry. We're just not a cast. We're not a cast for ugly people. That's what it comes down to. We're not... We don't enjoy ugly viewers. We don't like the ugly pictures they sent us. I'm sorry,
Scott. I am for hair lip people. Okay, oh. I cater my radio styles to them, and you didn't welcome them as they're listening right now. I hope you're pleased.
Is that what you're offended about this week?
Yeah, there's just a lot. Not just this week, for like the past 2.5 weeks. I mean, before then, I couldn't care.
Why, you're not going to renew your contract?
You know, I'm going to have my lawyers look through the paperwork, see if I got an out. I mean, maybe I don't show up on Monday. I don't know. Maybe
sitting out.
Yeah, maybe the people of the RTF Sports Network will be like, yo, what's this solo shenanigans about?
You're not going to. You're not going to show up to the practices we do each morning, like when we do the all our vocal warm ups in the morning. La 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 la. You're not going to come to those either.
Well, I mean, I'm going to go to one where I catch balls from Tom Brady. I'm not going to stop going down to Florida every morning to catch balls from Tom Brady. But you know, the verbal warm ups. I don't know. You know, maybe I sprained a vocal cord. I don't know, Scotty.
Are you looking for a Mahomes-like contract on your next signing here?
Only Mahomes-like? Only Mahomes-like?
Yeah.
You think this town is only worth half of a billion?
Yeah.
Listen, this little boy wants the whole pie, okay?
I'm totally isolating that clip and just playing it at random. This little boy wants the whole pie.
Listen to Verbal Shenanigans. This boy wants the whole pie.
So yeah, we'll get you to a Mahomes-like contract. If you just heard, was it 10 years? 10-year contract, right?
10 years. At first, I heard it was $400 million, but some people are telling me it's like
$450. I heard. I think.
Yeah, $450, something like that. I mean, maybe with incentives that goes to half a billion.
What's crazy is he'll only be 34 at the end of that contract. This is like very non-football like contract. This one, this is more almost like a baseball contract. Maybe it's ironic because his dad's a baseball player, but you don't see a lot of these mega long, tons of guaranteed money type deals in NFL.
Well, I think you all got to start thanking Kirk Cousins for like putting his foot down and saying, I want a fully guaranteed contract. And all these owners are like, no, no, no. And then Minnesota looked at their situation. They're like, all right, we'll guarantee for 3 years. And then once you open that door just a crack, then every other quarterback is like, ahem.
It is relatively conceivable that he could last through this whole contract and possibly sign like another contract with the Chiefs at some point. It is conceivable. I mean,
you got to give him the credit because a lot of these teams are like, I think he was still on his rookie contract. I think this was like the first.
Oh, he's still got 2 years left on it, I think.
He was still, they could keep him on his rookie contract and not blink an eye, but they literally, it's like, you know what? We know whatever happens, the salary cap always goes up.
Yep.
And we always know that, you know, once you sign somebody for like 3 years for a certain amount, then he's going to see the next guy get that next bump and he'd be like, what the hey? So they just like, you know what? We're not going to worry about this anymore. Here you go.
And I was like flipping through like ESPN or something like that. And I forget who it was. It might've been like Hasselback or one of those bums. I wouldn't have signed it. He would have got a lot more in free agency. I'm like, you realize he just set himself for life, and that's 2 years that until his contract that he could break a leg, throw his arm out, get knocked out. You know, like he could just be half the man he is now, and he just locked himself. Like at some point, the amount of money is more money than you'll ever need in your life.
I mean, it's not even worth the hassle of getting extra. I mean, half. Either close to or pretty much half a billion, how much do you need to finagle? I mean, what are you going to do with like three-quarters of a billion?
Not to mention what that guy's going to make in endorsements and everything else. Oh. He's the number one guy basically now. You know, he's got to be top three in the NFL at least as far as popularity, so. You know? Yeah. I mean, I looked at his contract, Mike, and right now, so just today, you want to think in 1 day, what do you think Patrick Mahomes makes?
In one
day.
All right. I am going to say $74,000.
Patrick Mahomes makes $137,800. Let me try this number again. $137,808 per day. Mike, what do you think Patrick Mahomes makes per hour?
Well, you divide that by 24, so that's relatively around 6,000 an hour. Somewhere.
Yeah, $5,472 an hour, Mike. So every hour, a nice $5,000. So per minute, okay, that means he makes $96 per minute.
My God.
And my favorite one is $1.60 per second. So every second, someone's handing you $1.60. Ping, ping, ping. Now, here's a question I'll pose to you. Would you take that contract, okay? The exact numbers Patrick Mahomes is getting, right?
Mm-hmm.
However, someone has to hand you that $1.60 in cash every second for those 10 years.
So literally now out here, do I have to like literally walk? Is he walking with me as I'm going to places and placing the money?
Oh, he's walking. Hand? Yeah. He's kind of like giving it. Maybe like when you sleep, we'll say that he's just kind of tossing $1.60. So that means in the morning, you got to like pick up your dollar. Like think about that. That is 10 years of mental just warfare going on, but at the end of it, you have $450 million.
It's one of those. Even if I regret the decision, I'm not going to regret the decision in the end. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Could you? I'm sure could you make it?
I'd be like, can you just put it on my counter?
It would be great if it was $1.60 too. Like it wasn't a check, or it was literally like the change is just.
All them quarters and nickels getting plunked at you.
Just go away!
I get it. I'm rich.
All right, fine. So he's not there every second, but could you let him pay you $96 a minute?
I'll be down. I mean, that's just straight cash that goes in my pocket. And
every minute, there's a little guy in like a suit comes out and sticks $96 in your pocket. That's what it's like to be Patrick Mahomes.
I mean, is he like dressed up? Does he have like a
sure? He's dressed up. On? Are you kidding?
Like, I would make this like almost like a TV show kind of moment. I mean,
well, I know.
Be like rappers looking at me like, yo, I gotta get this kind of deal. Why not?
Yeah. Like I thought about like before this, like, yeah, like if you could take the exact like stats of their deal, but had to make it almost unbearable, like how long someone can go and if it's worth the money. Like I said, yeah, and he's totally dressed up. You think I'm just gonna put some average like little guy or some tiny girl or something like that to come out. If maybe she comes out in a bikini and sticks it in there. Maybe he's in like a Monopoly type suit and he's just like, haha, like one of those curly mustaches.
It'd be great if you had the $1.60 deal, but every second he comes out with one of those like novelty big checks that you have to like grab from him. So you gotta hold 60 of them every minute.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I mean. So you just made, yeah, you made your, let's see, what was it, $137,808, but, Jesus Christ, I cannot read numbers today. Oh, my God, $137,808 in a day, but you have however many checks that breaks down to you that you have to go cash the next day.
I have to get a stamper to stamp them all because Lord knows I ain't going to sign every single one. And Lord help me, there's a line at the PNC bank, you know?
I mean, this is a great, like, movie idea, almost like Groundhog Day. But, like, it's the guy's got to try to outlast this contract. And if you can't last, they take all the money away.
I think we figured out the reboot to Brewster's Million.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, we just got to cast it, and I think it's golden.
I couldn't do the second. I don't think I could do the minute, but I could certainly do the hour. I think that's the point where I don't mind some guy, hey, here's your $5,472, and sticks it in your pocket. Something about him sticking in your pocket makes it really fun to me.
Like, even if, like, the deal expires, you'd be like, that's enough. Like, even if you last, like, 3 days, you'll have enough where you're like, all right, now I can buy a boat. Or something to that effect.
What if it's like a game show and you basically like, who wants to be a, you know how like you get to a certain point and you could quit and you get to keep that money. But this,
I would just have to hear like the rules. But I mean, I'm sure I could. Like I said, if I really put my mind to it, I'm sure I can last at least 3-4 days where I'm like, all right, this is like a year's. Home payments, you know what I mean? It'll be enough.
3 days, you would be at 130. Let's just round that off to 60. You'd be at like $390,000.
Yeah, there you go. I mean, I pay off my house. I can have a nice little vacation, and I can say, "Go away, little man. Stop putting stuff in my pocket." Okay.
But maybe you become friends with the little man. Maybe it's not even a hard relationship. Maybe you're enjoying that little high five you get every second with the $1.60.
I mean, that'd be awkward. I mean, then I wouldn't know what to have a conversation with him afterwards, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, like, it'd be one of those, like, we'd be tight for, like, a couple weeks after the event, but then you get, like, the weird, awkward, like, Facebook message or phone call where you're like, I don't want to talk to him. Oh, my God. We already talked about those 3 days already. He never talks about anything else. He asked me if I have other millionaire friends that want to do this deal. I feel he would get on my nerves eventually.
Okay. What if you got the $137,000 a day, okay, but mm-hmm. it was brought in by a dump truck and it was full of pennies, and you had to roll all those pennies in order to cash them? Like every day, on the front lawn, $137,000 in pennies.
I'd be fine with it. I mean, I guess I would go try to find a coin star and just start dumping them in there. I mean, I would have to give like Kroger 10% of it, but I mean, that's still, we're talking in the 10%, that's minus 13.
What if part of the deal is you have to stick each individual penny in the and wrap them.
Why do I got to wrap them? I mean, is this like game show rules we're talking about?
Yes. Yes. This is all right. This is my game show. I'm saying you're presented these different options on how to take the money, and you have to see if you could last. So basically, you got to roll that $137,000, okay, in order to keep it before the next dump truck comes.
All right, and how long do I got till the next dump truck?
You got a day. You got 24 hours.
There's no way to get all those pennies rolled in a day. That's physically impossible. I mean, I guess I could pay people, but in the end, I'd probably still only net like $80,000, which may be worth it. I don't know. I don't know how much Uncle Sam's going to take out of that. And then you say the next day I got to do it again?
Yeah, you got to. So basically, the money that you earn is the money that you until you can stop. So let's say you got a team of people that do the $137,000 in a day, and the next day it starts all over again. And you, once you quit, that's the money you keep. Okay, so there's that option. Now, there's the little man that pays you $1.60 every second. You know what else we got? What can we do with $5,000 an hour? I'm going to pitch this. I'm going to pitch. If they can have shows like The Floor is Lava and World Chase Tag and whatever the show that J.J. Watt stole from. I'm just blaming J.J. Watt. Yeah. They can have Patrick Mahomes' contract show.
I mean, if you copyright this, I could totally see this as a game show. It's got to be like the most annoying thing every like minute or something.
Exactly.
Because you gotta balance out. There's going to be, because with sponsors and everything, you need at least like five episodes of failures. You can't just have like winner after winner after winner.
Okay, so Bobby Bonilla's contract would be like the next episode, you know, like Bobby Bonilla. So you're gonna get paid to 2,000. I think it's 35. He gets paid too, and he gets like a million. So let's just round it off. He gets $1 million. But what if you have to shake 1 million people's hands during that year?
I mean, before this COVID thing, I'd be down.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, now it might be impossible to get 1 million people to shake your hand.
More challenge for the game show. Shake my hand, damn it.
Get back here. I'm only on 22,300.
Well, I don't know. What if you had Jacoby Ellsbury's contract? He hasn't played in like 4 years for the Yankees. But what if every day you had to hand paint the Yankee pinstripes on each Yankees uniform for each game? You had to pinstripe each one.
I would probably do it if there's not like a quality check on it. Like, I will attempt it, but you know they'll be looking like, what the hell is this?
It would look like
that. Around for 100 some odd years.
All crooked. It would look like, you remember those S's that kids would make on their like notebooks? Remember you start like three lines and make the why did that ever become popular? Like, I could draw this cool S.
I don't know. Kids are stupid. I don't know. It looked like one of those magic eye things where you stare at it and it looks like the uniform is moving for some reason.
Yeah, but it like took over. Every kid back then knew like that. There was a couple things you knew how to do. You knew how to make the S. You knew how to make a paper football. I could still make one of those. I could never make one of those fortune teller things, the little origami things.
Yep.
Yeah. Who are you going to marry? What's your favorite color? And it would be like, kids are
you
so
got courage.
Yeah, and I think there'd only be like eight options, but yet kids would just keep picking like different ones. They'd be like, I wonder what it is. I'm like, oh, you married Michael. Oh, no. You
know? Ah, no.
And I remember that game MASH. I don't know if you had that one. It was like, it would be like where you're living, how much money you're making, who you're marrying, and what kind of car you drive or something. Yeah, well, you just weren't cool enough, I guess. You were not cool.
I mean, we had pencil wars where you just go back and forth trying to crack the other person's pencil.
I got detention for that.
Okay. We had, like, the coin football where you got to get three coins and you hit it, and then you got to try to keep getting the coins in the middle, and then, like, the last one's got to be hanging over the edge but not fall off.
Oh, I didn't have that one. I had the one where you you spin the coin, like you flick it, and it spins, and you stop it, and then you can try to shoot the basketball. You could try to shoot into someone's hand or try to dunk the coin into their hands.
Yeah. So, like, you start off with, like, say, 3 pennies. So it's, like, the 2, and then there's a 1 right here, and then you hit the bottom one to break off the other 2, and then you're constantly pushing the pennies to go in between, and then you score a touchdown if you get the last – if you push your penny to the edge and it's like hanging, but
like
it's
a paper
not...
football.
Yeah, kind of like that. Yeah.
All right, I never played that one. This is, like I said, if I ever went through with that tournament of like kids' games, that would be a good one to play.
There you go. There you go. That's your second game show. I mean, you look at ABC, that's all they're doing through COVID on the weekends. It's like, hey, here's this Family Feud episode we recorded 7 years ago.
Yep. Yep. Well, I mean, I guess it's a good segue to our guest, considering we just talked about a football contract for 20 minutes or how to exploit a football contract. But I think it's time for a guest. Burlew, who we got?
Tonight we're going to be speaking with Wix Patton. He is a rising hip-hop artist. He was a former tight end for the Georgia Bulldogs who wrote the Dogs Anthem, or Ooga Anthem. His most popular song to date, 100 Miles, has been listened to over 500,000 times on Spotify, and his debut EP, Everything Okay, will be out later this year.
All right, let's get Wix Patton on the line.
Better?
Yeah, you're much louder now, man.
Cool, all right, we good now. Sorry about that, y'all.
No problem.
No problem. So you're a peach tree, born and raised in peach tree?
Yeah, I've grown up in Peachtree City ever since I was about like 6 years old. So yeah, you know, I guess you could call that my whole lifespan pretty much.
Okay. City.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I used to live over in Sharpsburg and all. My dad just, the only thing he told me about Peachtree is like, watch out for them damn cops, man. They're ready to just grab you for speeding, man.
They're ready to grab you for anything. They're ready to just, you know, make some sort of motions every single time. But no, I like Sharpsburg. I like NCG. I've been over to Sharpsburg a good bit, too.
Yeah.
I live, like, right by the border between Sharpsburg and Peachtree City.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm well familiar with that. No, I'm back up in Douglasville now, so.
But. Okay, yeah.
So, you know, I mean, we've been looking over your life. It's been an interesting story. I guess I would start, like, right around the beginning. Like, when you were younger, as we were going to talk about, like, your love of sports and music and all, did you have an early idea of where you wanted to lean towards when you were a kid?
I was always really into music growing up. It wasn't – and I was into sports as well, but it was nothing like – career path wise, it was really just my interest, you know what I mean? Was really into music throughout high school, but it wasn't until I really dove into football to like, you know, junior and senior year. And but yeah, I always knew I wanted to do music, but it kind of faded into the background whenever I took football more seriously, because I seen that was kind of like my way of honestly, it was my best pathway towards success, better than my grades, better than anything else I had going on, was that I had the opportunity with football. And so I went all in with that. And the music came back around, you know, obviously when I was at the end of my freshman year of college after we had gone viral. So, yeah, before that had happened, you know, I was always into music and that was my dream. But I was realistic enough to where it wasn't doing what where I thought it should have been doing. And I wasn't at where I thought I should have been at. So I just, you know, went all in on football. But, yeah, music has always been my love and passion for sure.
So as far as music, were you a kid who played instruments? Were you a kid who just was into listening to music, or did you play piano? What was your start?
I couldn't play any instruments at all. I wish. That's something that I definitely want to tap into. I guess I was always into songwriting. Like, I've always written songs even since I was a kid. Like, I would even write rap songs and star out the curse words, like, because I just felt like I wanted to, like, I just was into rapping, and then I was into just, I don't know, just even alternative rock writing even since I was a kid. So I was always into the songwriting element. And yeah, really, it just always appealed to me to want to be an artist. The first ever artist that I was like really truly inspired to say, okay, I could definitely do this, was D-Eazy. And that was when I was in the eighth grade, and I was like, 15, 14 years old. Right. And I had seen a music video that he had called Almost Famous. And I just watching him and seeing how he maneuvered and seeing how he rapped, it was just inspiring, you know, to me at the time to say, okay, yeah, I could really do this. And not only can I do this, but I can be unapologetically me doing this, you know? And that was just something that I got from him because, you know, a lot of people have influences that are artists that, you know, really inspire them. And maybe they go and they try to sound like them in the studio or different things. But seeing him really was something that encouraged me to want to just unapologetically be myself as an artist. So
when you're first getting on your feet as far as rapping like that, listening to hip hop and being influenced by that, especially so young, where are you trying to rap? Are you doing it in the bathroom, in the shower? Are you doing it with your buddies on the playground? Like, what are you doing?
You talking about like when I started out?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. No.
Man, for me, like me and my buddies, we were always freestyling like all the time. And it was something that I was doing on my own too, because it was like, I mean, you find something that you're good at, you just repetitively do it all the time. So it would be like in the car on the way to school, me and my brother are driving to school, I'm making him rap. I'm throwing on beats and I'm just playing them over and over again and I'm making him do it till he finally just starts doing it. Yeah. And me and my friends were doing it at the lunch table, you know, doing it at, you know, even middle school, recess. It was just different things. It was like, I don't know, it was like our own competitive thing, you know. So sure. I was always growing up rapping and just, it was something that came over, I guess, progressively. It came really natural to me. And so, yeah, it was all the time type of thing.
Was it a thing where you just kept it with the group, or were you like the kid is like, hey, let me throw something at you and just like do it in front of the class?
Oh, no, I wasn't doing nothing in front of the class. I think as far as a group, there was a group of us that were definitely rapping. But for me, it was like I was going just, you know, I was trying to get people to rap if they didn't normally rap. And then I was definitely surrounding myself with people that like, you know, that were liking to do the same type of things. So, yeah, I mean, it was primarily everywhere I went. You know, we were kind of doing that.
Hmm. Who was your, like, favorite, like, growing up? Like, either who came up with beats or just, like, who had the tightest lyrics? What was, like, one you would just go to, like, every time? Like, man, that's my number one.
You talking about when it came to beats, you said, say that one more time.
Yeah, whether it's like beats or lyrics, like what was like somebody you're like, I gotta be them when I grow up, or I gotta be.
Oh, okay, yeah, like
that.
Somebody who is like a real inspiration to me.
Yeah,
definitely. Okay, I would definitely say, artists like Coldplay, their group. I really wanted to be like them because I love the poetic lyricism that they had, and then I love the feel of the music that they had, as well as Justin Timberlake. I love the way that he was with the R&B and the soul and how he was smooth with it. But I had different inspirations too. I had, you know, I have rock inspirations like Linkin Park. And, you know, when it came to hip hop, it was like, I never really had, like, I had G-Eazy with somebody that I looked up to definitely when I was younger. But when it came to lyricism and flow, when it came to somebody like that, Young Thug was such a big part of somebody who influenced me to have like a stringless type of flow to where you can basically just, I don't know, you are in like, I don't know, like it's not as structured, you know what I mean? It's stringless to mm-hmm. me.
Yeah.
And so as an artist, you know, I guess it just gave me the freedom to really just bring out that creativity. You know, as a kid, you know, you're making noise. You're just, you know, what I say, like you're gonna cat, you know, like as a kid in elementary school, you're goofy, you know, all the goofy just kind of comes out when you're an artist because you're just unapologetically being creative. And somebody like Young Thug really brought that out in people. And so that was somebody that I wanted to be like, you know, in the sense of just how they did it.
I got to ask because it's been in my mind all day. being from Georgia and whatnot, yeah. Have you heard the new Run the Jewels album with Killer Mike?
I haven't heard it yet, but you know, I definitely respect them.
You need to listen to that. I need to hear your thoughts on that. But
wow, what you think?
Oh, it's so good, man! It's so good. I love it.
I'm gonna listen to it after this. Then I'm gonna definitely check it out. I've been so busy, really, just caught up in what I've been, you know, working on, and I just, even when I'm outside of the studio, I'm really listening heavily to what I'm working on, and just like,
yeah.
I'm somebody, I guess, who's just constantly critiquing what I have going on because I have such a high standard because of the people that I'm influenced by, you know?
Yeah. No, I
tap into other music too, but I do just spend a lot of time in my own little bubble. So I definitely got to tap into the new Run the Jewels album.
I just respect Killer Mike so much, just, you know, as a person and a voice. And I don't know. It's just, it's like listen to the album. It's like you preemptively saw what was going on in the country. It's funny. You got to listen to it, but it's pretty cool. But
I definitely will. I respect the artistry that they have, you know, completely.
Yeah. So when you start, you know, really getting to a level of athletics, I mean, you get to one of the best schools in the country as far as football. Are you suppressing your rapping and whatnot, or are you like out there to your teammates just kind of being like, yeah, this is what I do on the side? Like, do you hold it in, or were you completely open with it?
I'm so glad you just brought that up. So early on, I was rapping with just like a select different teammates, you know what I mean? Like people that just also enjoyed the freestyle. So it wasn't anything too crazy. I wasn't out there like, oh God, I'm a rapper, like I'm this. Like I had completely ditched, you know what I mean, like the high school past of me rapping and stuff like that, and was just fully in tune with being a UGA tight end, really. You know what I mean? Even my later years in high school, I kind of just like, you know, really let go of the thought of music for a while and just fully became this kind of like tight end and everything, and just kind of, you know, put the music behind me. But it really wasn't until I had, we were in LA for the Rose Bowl in Pasadena, and we had gone to a team event in California. It was at a comedy club. And they had an open mic. And before all the comedians came in and did their stand-up, or they didn't stand-up, they did improv. Before they came in and did that, some people, different teammates, Tristan Thompson and Dominic Sanders, were freestyling on stage. And they were like, anybody else want to come up here and rap something? And I just was like, I had my head down. I was not trying to go up there. I was not trying to be the meme of the year. I was not trying to be
the meme of the year.
You know what I mean? I'm sitting there. I got my head down. And a couple of my buddies are like, yo, come on. You need to go up there. Wix! Wix wants to go up there, yeah, Wix. And then different people start yelling like, Wix, yeah, Wix. Basically, I think most of the people just wanted to see me embarrass myself for real. And they probably just were like, okay, let's see what this kid's going to do. So Gant, who works for the team, he came up and said, Wix, if you don't come up here and rap, I'm going to tell Coach Smart that you were late for curfew. And so that, you know, of course, that means, you know, you're screwed. The next day, you know, you're going to be running suicides the whole practice. So it's just like, okay, I go up there. They put on a beat, and at the time, I wasn't even really rapping like that, but I guess it just felt natural. As soon as the beat came on, I started going, I freestyled for like 2 minutes straight, and they got it on video, and, you know, everybody was going crazy. It was one of the craziest moments of my life, honestly, because, you know, I'm up there, I'm standing up there, and all I see is just 100, 200 phone lights just up there in my face, and at the time, I wasn't rapping or anything like that, so it wasn't nothing normal, you know what I mean? It was like an experience I hadn't experienced, and so I don't know. I guess me rapping in that moment. I had done shows in high school, but it wasn't anything major. It wasn't anything but, you know, small crowds. And so in that moment, it almost just was like, I got off stage. Roquan Smith ran up there and said, no, Wix, you got to run it back one more time. So then I go back on stage, and this time everybody was videoing, even the UGA people had videoed it. And I came off, and then Chris D'Elia came up and did a stand-up. But then later that next day, we had you know, I'm talking with some buddies before the team meeting, and they're like, yo, one of my buddies, he's a walk-on. He said, yo, I want to post on Twitter and just put White Migos. Because at the time, Migos had been heavily involved with UGA. And, you know, Quavo had been around the team a lot. And one of the comedians had called me a White Migo. And so they just tweeted White Migos. And, you know, within like an hour, it had near 100,000 views on Twitter. And it had just gone crazy. Because all of a sudden, all the UGA players started retweeting it. All the fans started retweeting it. The college football accounts retweeted it. WorldStar came in and just became Georgia followers, and it just became a huge thing. And so after that moment had happened, it was like, you know, to me, honestly, it felt like everyone's perception had changed towards me. And I had almost like this newfound identity of like, yeah, he plays on the team, but this kid can rap. So it was just became a thing now where it's like, okay, yeah, he's a dude on the team that can do this. So it was all the time I was rapping. It was like they would pull me up in front of the team and they'd say, okay, Wix, you got a freestyle right here, or else we're going to run five more sprints, five more 100. I would be like, oh, my gosh. Okay. And so, you know, I mean, it's like everyone's out of breath. You know, we're running. No one wants to sit there and rap. So I would, you know, I'd go up there and just rap. And that was just kind of like my new identity.
Good conditioning.
Yeah, like it was what it was. So I was just kind of like, cool. Like, you know, they always put me under pressure. So, I mean, It was dope because at the time, you know, I didn't realize what it was developing for me character-wise, confident-wise, and just like the kind of platform that I had unknowingly, you know, like so many rappers, so many people, millions of people make music, but, you know, with me having the UGA fan base already keen, and not only the UGA fan base, but at this point, college football, a lot of the college football community was seeing what was going on. I was like, oh, shoot. You know, I had made music for 2 years in high school and never, ever got any type of attention like this.
Right.
So I'm like, okay, one of my buddies, Tyreek McGee, and I don't mean to talk forever, but I want to give this story. I haven't even given this yet. Me and Tyreek McGee, we had, he bumped me as soon as I came off the stage at the comedy club and said, hey, man, you got to start freestyling with us. So I was like, cool. The next day, not the next day, but when we get back from the trip, I go over to his house and we started freestyling. We decided we came up with a song called Whoa There. And we put it out on SoundCloud. And when we did that, you know, we didn't know what was going to happen. You know, I mean, we just put it out on SoundCloud and me and him both posted it. And then all of a sudden it was like, it went crazy. UGA blogs, New York Times. We woke up to a whole bunch of articles awesome. That had picked up. Yeah, it was crazy. They had picked it up and started talking about this single that we had, UGA football players. So I was like, okay, wow. Even though the music wasn't all the way up to par, I had seen that. I was like, dang, you know, music was always something that I've loved. But now I have the platform. Now I'm with people that are loving, you know, loving and supporting me and are behind me. And they've given me the confidence to, you know, really dive into something I've always wanted to do. So I kept pushing the music. And, you know, with me recording the music and with Tyreek, we put out an EP called The Experiment because we wanted to see, all right, this is an experiment. What happens if us as college football players and being at UGA, what will happen if we put out a tape? So we wanted to call it The Experiment EP. We put it out and, you know, it was crazy because not only, you know, were the fans and people supportive, but, you know, our coaches were playing it at team meetings. They were playing our music in warm-ups. They played it at the Sugar Bowl. They played it in all different types of places. You know what I mean? They were playing it. It was like it became part of, like, our team culture. You know what I mean? So it became much more than us just putting out some music. And honestly, through that, you know, it garnered enough attention for me to have people that wanted to invest in me to get, you know, come with me to the studio and introduce me to people and, you know, get me in conversations. And I was recording 5 nights a week my sophomore year while I was in Athens. And I was driving, you know, an hour and a half after football practice and meetings and everything and driving out to Atlanta. And we were recording till about 4 or 5 in the morning. I would drive back in my driveway. It'd be like 5:30 in the morning. I'd try to sleep for a few hours, go to class, try to stay awake. Damn near impossible to stay awake in class. I was like, you know what I mean? But, you know, I just kind of did what I had to do, and I found that through that and through that sacrifice of being able to do football at such a high level, have the support of a team and a community who didn't even need to support what I was going on because we were a football team. It wasn't like we had anything going on with music. So it just, you know, it ended up building all of that, you know, gave me the confidence and gave me the platform and gave me the ability to turn into a full-time artist, you know, now. And so, yeah, you know, it's kind of been something that, you know, has always been a passion and a dream of mine, but it wasn't until the opportunities opened the doors for me to realize it's something I could really do.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, it's awesome.
That's an amazing story. Now, tell us about the conversation that you had when you had to basically decide between music and football, because it's kind of like the story you were saying, how you're balancing school and practice and recording was amazing, but I'm kind of intrigued, like, what was that conversation like? Were they basically saying, since you're trying to make money off of music, you can't do football, or was it
never? Well, for a little bit of time, like, my coaches knew what I was doing, too, as far as, like, the amount of time and everything I was putting in. They saw the work, and so they were influencing me, like, you know, this is what you're passionate about, you know, you can do this, but it got to a point, though, where it was, like, it was, you know what I mean, it was a team thing where I was talking to the coaches and I was telling them, you know, like, this is obviously what I love doing, but they were telling me it was getting to a point, you know, where I was like, you know, it was already a lot. And then, you know, as we're already having this discussion with me and Coach Chaney and then my workout coaches, because they loved it and they all were behind me on it, but they seen how much it was just putting on me physically and mentally. And then, you know, before I can even make a decision off of that, the NCAA compliance comes in town. And I sit with them and I meet with the UGA compliance and we talked about basically what I had going on and that I was breaking the rules because I was profiting off of UGA's name because I had dropped a Go Dog song and they were saying that, you know, me doing Go Dogs was like Sony had done the same thing, but he didn't put it out on platforms that can profit. So me putting it out on Spotify and Apple Music, they were saying you're profiting off of UGA's name and likeness. And so I had, you know, obviously I had dropped other songs and had done the UGA anthem, and it had garnered a whole bunch of attention on social media. So they're like, you need to take all that down, take all the music down. Any money that you've made, you need to donate, you know, basically telling me everything that I was doing was against the rules. And so I was already faced with a decision at that point where I'm like, okay, you've built up all of this. You love football. You're going to have to make a decision here. Do you want to push and go try to make it to the NFL and keep doing college football? Or do you want to go ahead and go all in with the music? Because I'm not somebody who's going to halfway do something. You feel me? Because that's not how you make it. That's not how you become successful. That's not how you become great in the long run. A lot of people try to wear different hats and do a lot of many things, and I understand that. But at the end of the day, I understood that for me to be where I wanted to be, I was going to have to either go all in with football or go all in with music. I met with Coach Chaney. I talked with Coach Smart. I had talked to my coaches and told them what I wanted to do, and they all believed me and were behind me. And so after the Sugar Bowl, that was my last day of UGA football and UGA in general. I decided to drop out because I decided that if I was going to go full on with being an artist, that I was not going to halfway do it, that I was going to go all the way with music. Yeah. I was going to make sure that I was spending every single day, you know, transitioning into being a full-time artist, because 4 days after leaving UGA, I went to Greenberg Traurig to meet with an attorney, and we ended up getting to meet Don Perry and Joel Katz, who ended up sitting down with very music moguls, their attorneys, entertainment attorneys. And so they ended up, you know, talking to me and ended up, you know, putting me in the position to be able to turn into an artist and not somebody who was wearing two hats. You know what I mean? Somebody who was a UGA football player and making the music, because at a certain point, you can only, how much can you grow from being a college football player that raps? You're under that title. How much more can you grow from that? I wanted, and I knew that, you know, as soon as I started to, you know, get into situations where it was taken more seriously as me as an artist, I understood that you're more of a moment if I just try to do that. And there's no way that I can be compared to artists like Sheeran and some of the greats, Chris Brown. And, you know what I mean? Like, there's some of these great artists that I want to be like if I'm trying to just be anything other than who I wanted to be as an artist. So, yeah, over this year, I've gotten to really transition into being that full-time artist. I have a full catalog. I have a full team around me. And we have a full rollout plan of some singles that we're coming out with in June and July that are going to be crazy, with claymation, animation, music videos, a day in the life series. It's going to consist of showing what a day looks like for me, from running at 3:30 in the morning to 5:30 in the morning, to going to the studio every single day, to just the different aspects of what it looks like being in that kind of like space.
Is it a coincidence that you were born with a perfect rap name? Like,
yo, I say that all the time. Like, it is working out perfect, just being able to have my name, because I've always wanted to be able to, like, you know, everybody looks for that kind of name, and I, you know, I guess I just, you know, luckily
it's got an X in it. It's got the perfect amount of syllables. It has a good flow to it. Like
yeah, like for Daniel McGaffrey. Yeah, it might be a little bit harder to get on the scene.
Yeah. It's not about the name; it's about who owns it. I'm telling you. But
what is the background of your name, though?
Okay, the background of my name. So my grandfather, he is a veteran from the Air Force, from the Vietnam War, and his call sign was WX, Wix. So everyone called him Wix because WX means weather, and his last name is Weathersby. And so they were calling him Wix all the time. And so whenever I came out the womb and was born, they said, we want to give you the birth name Christopher Patton, the name after my father, Chris, but we want to name you after your grandfather, Wix. So I've gone by Wix in school, you know, everywhere in my life I've been called Wix.
That's a great story.
But the lawyers, you know, the doctors, they call me Christopher. And, you know, for a while I thought about just changing it straight to Wix Patton, but then I decided, you know, if I am in the doctor's office or I am in court, I think it would be okay to not be going by Wix Patton. You know what I mean? So, especially if I want to be successful in the type of
places that
I am taking with Christopher Patton, you know, I think it'll be okay. So
I love that it has a pretty significant story behind that. I dig that.
Yes, sir.
It's pretty cool.
your most popular song, 100 Miles, and I was checking out. I really dig it. I love the guitar on it. It's almost like an Ed Sheeran kind of vibe to it. And no, what was the thought process going into making that song in the video?
So actually, it's crazy because I'm actually sitting next to Tyler, who played the guitar on 100 Miles.
Hi, Tyler.
Hey, that was good stuff, Tyler. Seriously, shout out to you.
Oh yeah, he's great. So. I actually made that song while I was still going to UGA. That was like, of the collective, we made like 30 songs, I think, while my sophomore year of UGA. And each song we made was live instruments. So like I had put together a band of people to, you know what I mean, to come in, and we had violinist and we had an electric guitar player, which was Tyler. We had an acoustic guitar player. We had a bass guitar player. We had a drummer. We had a producer who was doing the arrangement. But basically, behind 100 Miles was Tyler was in there, and it was our first time ever working together, and he just was in there, and it was a four guitar loop of him just playing, and we looped it out, and then he went and he played a different part for the hook, so it had no drums in it. It was just the guitar part, and I went in and sang the 100 Miles, the whole song, with it just sounding the exact same the whole way through. So yeah, literally it had no drums, it had no anything in it. I just sang it all the way through how it was. And then after Steve Hibicki came in and he brought that island type vibe to it, he went and arranged it, and he added drums to it and created a whole other vibe to it. But yeah, originally it was literally just like a whole bunch of ad-libs, a whole bunch of vocals, and just me and Tyler on the guitar. So
love it.
It actually had 17 different versions until I got to the last version too.
Well, personally, I'm a fan of. Personally, I'm a fan of version 13. I really loved version 13, but you know, version 17 is okay.
Man, I'm telling you, some people are just psychopaths when it comes to just getting that. You know, they'll hear one little thing and they'll be like, I got to change that.
100%.
I got to change that. But I'm thankful for that craziness, because at the end of the day, it gets the final product how it needs to be.
For sure. I mean, Wix, it's awesome to hear. Like, you clearly have, you know, you could tell when someone's found what they want to do in life and what they want to do with their artistry and whatnot. And you could hear it in your voice. So it's really cool to talk to you and interview. So what do you have on the horizon, and what's the best place for people to follow you?
Hey, one more thing, though, because we did bring up 100 Miles. I've literally never done this in an interview either. I have 100 Miles tattooed on my arm. I don't even know if you can see it.
Oh, nice.
It's like on a cassette tape.
Yeah, we got it.
Oh, yeah, yeah. There it is.
100 Miles. I got it on a cassette. This is like my first ever tattoo. And I got it there just – and I got the roses in it too because of the Rose Bowl. And I wanted to signify, like, I got this tattoo after my first – it was like my first big show at UGA, because I did a lot of frat shows while I was there, fraternity shows and just different events. The next day I told myself, like, I had met a tattoo artist the night before. I said, look, if he hits me up, I'm going to go get a tattoo, and I'm going to get something that signifies that music is what I'm going to do with my life. And so he hit me up that morning while I was in downtown Athens. And that day, you know, I was supposed to go home. I ended up going to the tattoo shop for 5.5 hours and sitting there and letting him putting this on there, you know, this whole piece. I got the roses to signify the Rose Bowl and how that allowed me to enter into the type of life that I wanted to be able to do in that moment, in that space of time. And then I got the cassette tape, 100 Miles, because I dropped that song when I was, you know, still playing for UGA. And that was the first song that people took me serious enough to say, yeah, you could be an artist. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I had so much music that I still wanted to put out, but we ended up not even putting it out. But yeah, that was the first song that people took me seriously enough to say, okay, you could really do this. And obviously after I did the song and it started to do well, I got offered to get flown out to Beverly Hills to shoot the music video. And it was a life changing experience. So I got that tatted on me. I know that has nothing to do with what we said, but
it's great to hear.
Oh no.
But I'm also amazed that you know what a cassette tape is. You're so young.
Come on, man. Come on, man. I know all about the cassettes. I used to have a little cassette, little sack. I used to jam out.
All right.
I remember, like in high school, like moving to the Discman, and like I got the one that wouldn't skip, and then we had to run for soccer, and I tried to run laps, and it would just go like it would just skip the entire time, and then there'd be an error in it, and then you have to finish the lap trying to adjust the CD on your waist. Awful.
It did look so
good. I had the one where you had to plug in the cassette into the radio and it was attached
that was
like
good
a wire
too.
To the CD player. And then, like, every time you hit a pothole, man, you just like, son of a bitch.
Whoever made that, though, whoever made the tape into wire gizmo is pretty genius, man. That I mean,
hey, because you got to think about it, though. In order for us to get to where we are now with technology, you got to take those steps. You know, you got to build off of what you've learned, and then you take this, and you take it to get there.
Yeah. So, Wix, where should people go to follow you and check you out and see what's going on with you?
So, basically, you can find me on all platforms under Wix Patton. You can, you know, obviously find out a lot more about me when it comes to interviews, when you can see live shows. You can see the latest music that's out, all YouTube videos. You can see everything on wixpatton.com. So, that's the central site, wixpatton.com. But you can find me on all social media and all platforms, Wix Patton. So I appreciate y'all having me on the show so much. And I appreciate y'all's time. And I'm sorry, obviously, that we had that confusion early on trying to get the TV and the computer and everything.
Oh, no problem. But,
oh, no problem, man. No problem. Now, one last question. Now, I can tell you got a ton of passion. And I'm really thinking you're going to make it in this world. Now, when you do a tour and you hit all the colleges, what is the last college you're going to hit? Is it LSU or Alabama or Knight?
Yeah.
Honestly, like, so I don't know. You're asking funny shit on what you're saying? Shit, we're going to hit Alabama. We're going to hit Alabama last, and we're going to do a show, but we're not going to show up. We're going to book it, we're going to sell it out, and we're not going to show up.
I love it.
We're going to sell it out, and we're not going to show up. And we're going to say, and we're going to have a UGA banner that just comes down slowly. And then as the banner comes down slowly, the screen is going to open up, and it's just going to be me. It's going to be me, and I'm going to go.
Middle fingers in the air. That's awesome.
I was just playing. Shout out Alabama. I'm going to go to all these spots, but yeah, nah. This is being funny.
Wix, thanks so much for your time, man. And really, good luck with what you're doing and good luck with the music career. I think you're on the right path, man.
Hey, thank y'all so much. And thank y'all for having me. And good luck to y'all as well, obviously. You know, we're going to keep growing. And hopefully we can do another interview soon in the future.
Absolutely. All right, Mike. Wix Patton. That's a guy born to rap. I mean, or sing or have like some kind of name in entertainment. It's just the name flows too well. Like Scott Brennan doesn't, no one remembers that name.
Like, yeah, I mean, it'd be a shame if he was named Wix Patton and he went like into insurance.
Yeah.
Or the family. No! I don't care if you're an amazing brain surgeon. We expected you on stage.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, this is Wix Patton from Progressive. Doesn't sound as cool as but it's a good tight end name too. It really is a good tight end name. So
yeah, it's almost funny how like the NCAA goes up to him and he's like, "Yo, you're making money. We can't stand for this. You're gone." Oh, by the way, before you go, can we scan your face so we can put you in our video games?
They're the worst.
They're so terrible, and they still try to play the whole, oh, they're getting an education thing. It's like, shut up.
Yeah, you know what? You know when we'll see when their true colors shine? When all these classes, right, and all these things are going, everybody's digital now for the fall semester, and we'll see when the athletes are allowed to come play football for the school, how much they really care about just their athletics. Just their education. That's when we'll see the, you know.
Well, they'll use the TV cameras to point at the field so they can say, well, tactically they were all in class today.
Yeah, yeah. And they'll be like, oh, yeah, it's safe for the Notre Dame football team to come on campus, but nobody else. Yeah, you'll see.
No. No,
you'll see.
Women's lacrosse? Nope, sorry, too dangerous for you. Was that a billion-dollar football team? Yep. We're good. We got stuff for you.
Yeah. So
on a side note, did you see the video? Like the WNBA is starting up as well as the NBA, and they're like in a different part of Florida. I forget where.
Okay.
But, like they did. One of the players did like a video of like the quote unquote house bubbles they're in, and the laundry room has like mouse traps on it, and there's holes in the wall, and
I thought you were, here's like what I the, thought you were going to say for a second. I thought you said they were showing footage of the bubble, and it turned out just to be the a regular season game that was empty.
Nah. Them girls work hard.
I'm of course they do. They don't have any fans, though. That's the problem. That's
yeah,
the
it's
problem.
Gotta build, you know, but it's just so sad and all how it's like. It's one thing to have that debate where they're like, well, we should be paid as much as the men. You're like, well, you definitely need more.
Yeah.
But then there's the debate of, okay, who gets LeBron money and stuff like that. But it's just looking at the conditions. It's like, oh, come on. You can't, you know, you're the NBA. You know, you're worth billions upon billions.
Try a little bit.
You have your own network. I don't think you're struggling to put them up into at least like a 4-star hotel, okay?
In fact, I don't know. For some reason, I think like this time period might be some kind of interesting way to, I don't know, put a spotlight on the WNBA somehow. I don't know. Like, just because there is like not as much hustle and bustle around sports and things are starting at different times, maybe you can come up with a creative way to kind of, I don't know, get their talent out there to people who would never watch it. I mean, it's like, look, like a lot of people are watching NASCAR right now. I've heard a couple of people like, hey, I was watching racing. I had nothing. I watched golf the other day. I watched UFC. I never watch UFC. So people will watch when there's nothing else to watch. So who knows?
If you get the spotlight with nothing else on, you can grow an audience. That's for sure.
Yeah. Mike, we just found out something interesting right before we hit record again here on the podcast. My wife had stopped in to say hi to you and just say hi to me. She was home from work and
she's glowing and lovely.
Yes, yes. We are 26 weeks, which means if she goes full term, that's only 14 weeks away. When you say 14 weeks, it doesn't sound like a long time. That's only like, if we keep this pace up, that's only like 28 more interviews, Mike, until.
Yeah.
You know,
and that's something when you get like a work assignment and you're like, oh, it's 14 weeks away, no problem. And then you start it 2 days before it's due.
Exactly. And you're like, oh boy, 14 weeks. So it's basically like a semester away in college. But what we ended up talking and you said, you had asked when the due date is. And I said October 18th, not putting two and two together.
What's important about October 18th, Scotty?
I don't know, man. I'm hoping is she holds out one day or goes one day early, because I don't know if I can handle having your birthday and the baby's birthday on the same day.
Scotty, it's destiny. We've been doing this podcast for so long. It was destiny when you had your first child. It would share a date with me. So...
You know what? I mean, the one of the name options was Michael Burlew Brennan. Maybe it'll happen.
I mean, I don't see why there's other options once that comes up. I mean, now everything else just sounds silly to me. In fact, that's what I'm going to call your kid, regardless male or female.
Male, female, whatever. Make sure you say both names too, right? Michael Burlew Brennan every single time.
Absolutely. You know, that's their full name. It's like a hyphen in there to make it special.
Well, on that note, like, I mean, I would hold you to it that you would never be able to forget his birthday or her birthday, and that you would have to probably share your birthday presents, I think, with my kid.
Well, no, a good teaching technique is to give me all the presents and teach them that your present is being born on
now,
the same day.
Now you're trying to steal my kid's presents. Not only does he have to share his birthday with you, now he'll have to give his presents.
Well, here's what happens. You give me all the presents, right, and me being the gracious person I am, I will give your child one of the presents back.
So it's almost like you're paying tribute. Like it was your, like you own that, the block, and he's got to pay you a certain amount. See, I think you should like at least start it like, okay, you're going to take 30% of the presents. So every, you know. Like a fee, like an old mob, like, you know, running costs. So you want all of his presents, though, which I find a little bit greedy.
Well, like I said, I will show my humbleness by giving one back. I mean, likely it'll be the one I least like, but still, it will teach your child to not be selfish.
Gotcha. And every day, every year on his birthday, he sees all those packages and friends coming over with boxes for him and sings happy birthday, and as soon as he blows that candle out, we come in with the red wagon and the garbage bags and just shove all the stuff in and be like, it's got to go to Uncle Mike. Sorry.
Yeah. You just, after he blows out the candles, I just bust down the door. Where's my stuff? What? Time to pay the birthday boy.
So you don't care either. You'll just take onesies and rattles, bottles. It doesn't matter. You just want the tribute.
I can find various uses with any kind of object. It's all up to me to be the better person and what I get back. And if you tell me now, Mike, my son or daughter had a very good year, I might just go, you know what? You're worth two.
Wait. So now you're like the Santa Claus of this situation? Now you're like the mob boss?
Yeah. I mean, you know, it could be an open discussion where, like, I get all the gifts and then you're – son or daughter has to read an essay on why they deserve the most amount of gifts back, and I will judge how many gets returned to them.
Wow. Okay. So it doesn't, like, even alleviate as the years go on. It just comes down to your ruling on what you're feeling, how you think they did.
Like, one year, the story might touch my heart, and I'd be like, that's beautiful, take them all. And one year I might be like, you know what? You phoned it in. I'm sorry. I can't reward you for that presentation. And I mean, looking at the PowerPoints, the graphs are off. You know, I looked at the references. It's not in the correct font. I can't accept this sloppy work.
See, you're accepting that if you shared birthdays that you become some kind of power source over, which we're finding out through these podcasts that there's a power thing with you. I feel like you have dreams of you being like a, you know, like giving the thumbs up or thumbs down at gladiator fights, and like you're kind of like people just like,
yeah.
So you're, you know. I don't like that you're interpreting that you get something. Maybe you should be giving all your presents to my child. Like I should take your birthday from you.
Well, let's be honest. I haven't really received anything from you for my birthday pretty much since win, lose, or draw. So you're pretty behind.
So now your child is
taking over your debt right now.
Now you expect a game show podcast with surprise party, basically, every year.
Yeah. Like last year, my wife's like, you want to go to the grocery store? And I'm just like, Oh, sure. We're just going to a regular grocery store. And then every time I went through a corner and looked down the aisles, you were nowhere.
Yeah. And you were like, you know, asking old men, like, hey, you're not Rich McDonald. Like, oh, you're not Joe Frenette. Where is everybody?
Yeah. I opened up the dairy case. I was throwing the milk cartons out, figuring one of you guys were hiding behind there, but I never found any of you. It was a very sad day that year.
Now, for those of you who don't know what the hell Mike's talking about, I'll tell you how this is hurting me, because I gave Mike a very special birthday one year, and now he's trying to take my unborn child's birthday away from him already. The kid hasn't even been born yet. So one year, Mike was turning 40. And what did I tell you? We were doing an interview with
We were going to a bar in West Orange. I believe initially you say we were going to talk to Rich and Rich McDonald and Joe Carney. And I think he also said KB Burke originally. This was like a couple months before the full plan was there, saying like,
yeah,
oh, we're going to do like an interview about like their improv or the shows that they do down
there. Something like that. Yeah. Yeah. So I had basically, I don't even know how it came together, because it kind of, to me now, it seems like a hard task. that was a big undertaking. But essentially what I did was throw Mike a game show about him. So Mike wasn't really, maybe he thought it was like, eventually he might have been tipped off a little bit. But I don't think you ever knew exactly what you were walking into, correct?
I didn't. I knew it was kind of like, even when you said it like that, I kind of assumed, okay, this is going to be some surprise thing. But obviously, I did not know, okay, we're recording a podcast at night, like a game show, or or people, some of my other friends were there as well. I did not foresee that coming.
Yeah. So essentially there was four contestants, and it's funny we're actually talking about this, because I think I said the other day, oh, it's right here. I brought up Google Drive, my Google Drive, and it said, hey, Burlew Game Show. I'm like, oh, yeah, and I actually, like, read through it. I don't remember a lot of things. I wrote basically an intro for, it's funny, I wrote, like, an intro with, like, a joke or two about each comic, and then I wrote, like, a four-paragraph roast on Doug Max introducing him. So basically there was four guests.
Contestants,
yes. And each correct answer, they earned 5 points. Each question will have, and each question or round had a bonus question. And there was a couple rounds. So the first round was Burlew, Are You? And it was all about Mike's upbringing. There was a question about him liking the Dukes of Hazzard. There was a question about where he was born. There was a question about him playing a toothbrush at the school play. And the bonus point question there was, what role would Mike Burlew be perfect to play? So that was and I would give points to the right, you know, the right answer. Then there was even a picture section. We hooked up a TV. It had pictures of Mike, and you had to caption the photos on what he was doing. I don't really remember too many of the photos, but
That section that I don't even remember.
Yeah,
on that.
There's like
I remember the one where you gave, or basically they had to bet if I could say the word.
Oh yeah, the vocabulary.
If I knew the meaning of it, and if I could use it in a sentence, and I think I did pretty damn good.
Yeah,
the first word I cleared out.
The first word I have here was Sioux, the Sioux Indians. Oh, yeah.
Sioux Indians, yeah, and I think the second word was equinox.
Yep. Then there was lambast, and then there was also vos deferens.
Was that the word? I remember it was some kind of French phrase or something to that effect.
Well, the vos deferens is the sperm carrying duct in the male anatomy. So, I don't know, but yeah, there was a couple of different things. Anyway, so. Basically, we took something from Mike's apartment. We took this old head that he had. You might want to explain the old head, Mike.
Yeah. So when I was alone and I just tried to think of ways to, like, decorate my apartment.
Right.
What I did was, one day at Pier 1, they had a glass head. It's a bowl in the shape of a head, kind of like a mannequin head, but it's glass.
No.
And
now, when you went at the Pier 1, you were looking around. You're like, oh, there's a basket, or there's a candle, you know, there's a potpourri thing, maybe some throw pillows. And your eye shifted to this glass head. You're like, that's the piece that's going to... That's going to get me laid. That is the piece that the chicks are going to be, oh, my God, this guy has an eye for design.
I mean, I didn't think it would get laid. I mean, being truthful here, like, I remember the first time Izzy came over to my apartment, and that was the night I was pulled over for drunk driving and the
that was the first DUI. Night? No.
That was the first night she ever came to my apartment. And it's kind of like, as awkward as the night was, I was like, my apartment really ain't that great. Just to give you a heads up before we go in there.
Oh, you were throwing puns out there, little heads up.
Now, that wasn't a part of it, but thank you for thinking that.
Oh, and Mike didn't really get, he wasn't really drunk and driving, just so you clear that story up.
Yep. It's a full, we'll get into that another day. I think we brought it up 3 or 4 times, but, it was just one of those, I mean, you kind of know me, like, anything that's kind of offbeat or weird, it just, sometimes some things gravitate to me, so.
Did it talk to you? Did it speak to you?
It did not speak to me.
Were you pulling like an Al Snow kind of thing? Were you talking to the head?
I did not talk to the head. It wasn't my best friend. It was literally a decoration where I took the glass head, then I bought red and green beads, and I filled the head with the beads. Then I put a plate under it, and I turned it around. And
I can't wait to isolate these two. So I filled the head with beads, and I saw it.
There's a lot of clips for boning this week's episode. And I guess also as time went on, I put a pair of sunglasses on it. Mm. And when I went to India and we went go-karting, they gave you like this like little beanie thing to put on your hair before you put on a helmet. And for some reason, I saw it and I put it as it came out to look like a bandana on the head. So I didn't think it was like the biggest deal. Apparently, you, Alex, my wife, all pretty much said this is the most insane, hideous thing on the planet. And it was a surprise to me that the ending of the show was they had my head, they put it in a bag, and then Scott rammed it with a hammer, and he gave me the pieces back.
These are really good memories. These really make me like warm inside. Yeah, we smashed it. Were you sad when we smashed the head?
I mean, not like depressed sad. I was a little bit like, oh, it wasn't that bad.
It was the grand finale, man. It was a
slight. I don't think anybody there who looked at the head kind of agreed with me, but it was my opinion. I have a right to my opinion.
It was, you got to remember, it was half roast, half game show. So it had to have a climactic ending.
I figure you just ended with "We love you, Burlew. Good night." But
we got you a Redskins cake. Come on, I mean that was
awesome. I still laugh how my wife tried to have the. What it was like, her friend came up and they lived. She lived in Freehold, to our apartment for them to drive back over to your place, stating that Alex ordered a cake just for the heck of it, to keep it over at your place.
Yeah,
that's. And on as a side note to the story, so on my birthday weekend, me and my wife went to a Redskins game as my gift. And when a big play happened, I turned around to hug my wife to see a Redskins cake on her phone where I'm just staring at it. And then she's staring at me, and then she got mad at me for looking at the phone where I'm like, why are you looking at Redskin cakes during the game?
Yeah. What we learned was not to tell Mike's wife a secret. That's what we learned from that part.
Yeah. My favorite thing was going into the night, like every time we're like, yeah, I'm getting ready for our just normal meeting at the bar tonight, honey. And she's like, shut up. What? I mean, we're going to meet up with Scott now. Just another normal night at the bar.
And the worst was I was like, you cannot say anything about the cake. You cannot. She's like, I won't. Difficult karma. Oops. And she's like, I won't do it. And then she would like be like, I'm not saying anything. I'm like, you're going to say something. I know you are.
To be fair, she never technically did, but she accidentally showed it. Well, it was a design of it. From what I recall, she like took a picture and sent it to her friend of like, this is what it should look like around. And so I saw the prototype.
Yeah. So long story short, you should be what I think as repayment for that. You should be throwing my kid a party each year for the next 40 years. I think that is a nice trade-off.
Sounds good. I will show up to your house with a big Redskins cake
and a head.
I'll literally just plop it in front of you and your family and friends and walk out. See you later. Scotty wanted this.
Yeah.
How about you explain for the rest of the night?
Was that your uncle? Just I don't know. Just don't mind
Scott,
him.
Scott, are you racist against Native Americans? No, it's a long story. It was a long time ago, okay?
Why did he have a head? Why does Uncle Mike give me a glass head every year for my birthday? I don't understand it.
Your kid is petrified. Is that weird man going to show up and break a glass head in front of me again? Yeah. I don't like birthday parties.
Well, son, if you listen to episode one whatever, and subscribe to the podcast, you'll find out.
Dad, I'm sick of talking about your podcast on our current events. Our teacher's getting mad at us.
Dad, we get it. Mike was a toothbrush. Why don't you guys tell the story again?
Dad, they didn't really understand who Wix Patton was.
On that note, I think it's time to get out of here. This is our Thursday edition of Verbal Shenanigans, and it's been another good one in the books. An episode of nonsense, if you will. Patrick Mahomes' contract, and you will be, now that my son or daughter is supposed to be due on your birthday, I'm going to really encourage Alex to either hold it in tight or babe, do you want to go for a run around the block on October 17th? Are you sure you don't want to do jumping jacks? You know?
Like on October 14th, she's like, honey, why is there putty next to the bed?
Just in case. Yeah.
We don't want any leaks too early or too late.
Oh, God. Burlew, anything to promote before we skedaddle, if you will?
Well, since we spoke about the Redskins changing their name, let's talk about Breaking Hate, Confronting the New Cultural Extremism, the book written by our former guest, Christian Picciolini. He's been a guest on our show. He's been on CNN talking about how he went from being a skinhead to a reformed person trying to help people get out of hate. Like I said, he released his book this year. Really amazing guy. You should check it out. The book's name is Breaking Hate, Confronting the New Cultural Extremism. Find it on Amazon.
And I will promote a former guest on the show. Her name was Hedvig Malestad. She was, I believe it was Sweden. I don't want to get that wrong. But anyway, she is a really awesome musician. She was part of the Hedvig Malestad trio. But she just put an album out under her own name, just Hedvig Malestad, and I know it's a mouthful, but it goes by the name Echidna, and basically it is about it comes from half man, half woman, half snake creature, Greek mythology, and it's really cool. I actually listened to it yesterday. I was just kind of beat from work and laid down and just kind of put it on. It's got this like jazzy, like trippy, then some heavy rock vibe. Pretty cool album, so go check her out at Hedvig Malestad. Their new album is Echidna. And I know you're going to have to use Google on that one. There's probably a lot of spelling mistakes. So just Google it, do the best you can, and you'll find it.
Yep. And that was episode 233 with Hedvig Malestad and Pat Cambyses.
Ah.
Cave Explorer.
Wow. I would not have thought that we put those two together, but, you know, we were a little weird. We were a little weird back then.
Yeah, you can never explain the knowledge of Verbal Shenanigans. No. That's for sure.
Well, the show keeps evolving, and guys, we are continuing to enjoy doing it. 311 episodes in with no sign of stopping. So if you're enjoying what you're hearing, if you're hearing it for the first time, please follow us on all the socials. And then the best thing you could do is share our podcast with your friend and go check out the past catalog. That's where we really shine. We've had a lot of amazing guests. Last Monday, we had Scales and Skinny from the Nappy Roots. Last week, we had Dryden Mitchell from Alien Ant Farm. So we've had a lot of really cool guests as of late. So go check them out. Don't just listen to this one. But that's it, guys. Life is funny. Laugh at it. Keep the wind at your back. And we'll see you on Monday. Bye-bye.
Can't wait to see your birthday, boy. Woo-hoo. Come to Burlew.
today. I just woke up and I like said this. No, instead of waiting on a good day, waiting around through ups and downs, waiting on something to happen. I just said, sounds like